Good morning. I want to welcome you, saying that no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here this morning. Today, we are having a pre-recorded service. I have my mask down because there's only two other people in the building who have their masks on, so I am far enough away to be able to stay safe and for them to stay safe. This afternoon, being Sunday at 2 p.m., we are having a time of fellowship that is coinciding with crop walk. Since there is no crop walk this year, many churches are having a virtual crop walk. And what that will entail is basically, if you come, you will have some time to sit around and chat, or you will also, if you feel up to it, can journey with us around the church grounds to raise awareness for ending hunger. The motto of the Church World Service Crop Walk is ending hunger one step at a time. And so we want to do our part. I want to remind you that pledge cards are due today. If you are coming this afternoon, please feel free to bring those pledge cards with you, or please put them in the mail as soon as you can so that you can get them, so that we get them as soon as possible. There is also many other things in that packet of information with the pledge cards, so please make sure you check out those various things that are happening. Seeing that there are no more announcements, let us turn our hearts and our minds toward God for our prayer. been nice being outside and having to remember to turn the microphone on. Please now remind me to join me in our call to worship. We are called to come away from the valleys of misplaced loyalty. We come seeking to meet the God of all worlds. We come together that our faith might be strengthened. We seek the strength to live by all that we profess. God continues to deliver us in times of distress. God's steadfast love endures forever. Let us be in a spirit of prayer to call forth God to be in this place with us for worship. Gracious God, you have invited and welcomed us to this place of worship and the places in our homes. You draw us away from idols we create to take your place. When we come together, we sense that there is nothing in life that can substitute for a vital relationship with you. Yet we are only dimly aware of who you are. All the mysteries of the universe are in your hands, yet you have made yourself known among the people of this earth. We catch glimpses of your work among us and are amazed. We want to meet you again today as for the first time. Touch us, remake us, and help us to stand firm in our faith. Amen. God is not fooled by our pious words of faith. God knows our golden calves, with possessions and situations that take our attention and resources every day. Like our ancestors before us, we have sinned and deserve God's wrath. As Moses implored God to spare the Hebrew people, we bring our petitions, seeking a fresh start. Let us pray. God of all mercy, you have planted within us a desire to observe justice and do righteousness. We want to be fair and honorable, delighting in life shared openly and honestly with family, friends, and co-workers. Instead, we are often defensive, fearful, and distracted. We spend more time with our toys than with your truth. We seek temporary thrills rather than lasting meaning. Then we are disappointed when our golden calves bring no fulfillment. We return to you, loving God, intent on following the guidance we are receiving from you. Save us from ourselves. Amen. We are people of faith and people who are sinful. We make ourselves things that seem more important to us, but God knows in our hearts that we love God more than anything. Jesus came down for us so that we might be forgiven by the grace of God and the sacrifice of Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
our scripture readings for today. The first one is taken from the book of Philippians, chapter 4, verses 1 through 9. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, my beloved. I urge Donia and I urge Sinton to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you also, my loyal companion, help these women, for they have struggled beside me in the work of the gospel, together with Clement and the rest of my co-workers whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. Our gospel reading for this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 22, verses 1 through 14. Once more, Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his slaves to call those who had been invited to the wedding banquet, but they would not come. Again, he sent out slaves, saying, 'Tell those who have been invited, look, I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they made light of it and went away, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his slaves, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. Then he said to his slaves, 'The wedding is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go therefore into the main streets, and invite everyone you find to the wedding banquet.' Those slaves went out into the streets and gathered all whom they found, both good and bad, so the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing a wedding ring. And he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding ring?' And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, 'Bind him hand and foot and throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen.'" In an Old Testament reading from Exodus chapter 32, verses 1 through 14. When the people saw that Moses delayed to come down from the mountain, the people gathered around Aaron and said to him, "Come, make gods for us. Who shall go before us? As for this Moses, the man who brought us out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him." Aaron said to them, "Take off the gold rings that are on your ears, that are on the ears of your wives, your sons, and your daughters, and bring them to me." So all the people took off the gold rings from their ears and brought them to Aaron. He took the gold from them, formed it in a mold, and cast an image of a calf. And they said, "These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt." others. He built an altar before him. And Aaron made proclamation and said, tomorrow shall be a festival to the Lord. They rose early the next day and offered burnt offerings and brought sacrifices of well-being. And the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to revel. The Lord said to Moses, go down at once. Your people, whom you have brought up out of the land of Egypt, have acted perversely. They've been quick to turn aside from the way that I commanded them. They have cast for themselves an image of a calf and have worshipped it and sacrificed to it and said, these are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt. The Lord said to Moses, I have seen this people, how stiff-necked they are. Now let me alone so that my wrath may burn hot against them and I may consume them, and of you I will make a great nation. But Moses implored the Lord his God and said, O Lord, why does your wrath burn hot against your people, whom you brought out of the land of Egypt with great power and with a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say it was with evil intent that he brought them out to kill them in the mountains and to consume them from the face of the earth? Turn from your fierce wrath. Change your mind. Do not bring disaster on your people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, your servants, how you swore to them by your own self, saying to them, I will multiply your descendants like the stars of heaven, and all this land that I have promised I will give to your descendants, and they shall inherit it forever. And the Lord changed his mind about the disaster that he planned to bring on his people. This ends the readings. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, our rock, our redeemer. Amen. Now last week I preached about the story that Jesus was telling about the party and who should be invited. This week's Gospel from Matthew is very similar, and so I decided to meditate and preach on the Exodus passage for this morning. Now, if we would have read the Exodus passage from last week, we would have read that story, the wonderful story of the Ten Commandments. When Moses receives the rules for God's people on the top of Mount Sinai. But did you ever realize that Moses doesn't bring the commandments to God's people yet? The scholars have debated whether or not the people of Israel heard the rules in the way that the story is told. But we can assume that if those people did hear the Ten Commandments when they were down at the bottom of the mountain and Moses was talking to God up at the top, if they knew, if they were listening, then they purposefully disobeyed those rules. But even though that was last week's text, this week we take a journey from chapter 20 of last week all the way to chapter 32 in Exodus. And we find ourselves at the place where Moses is again on the mountain. And people are getting bored and angry that Moses hasn't returned. So in their haste and what I'm thinking I would almost call boredom, we find that they decide to make an idol to worship. These Israelites don't feel that Moses is leading them properly anymore. They don't feel that God is guiding them. And so they decide to take off their jewelry and turn the gold into an idol. In their tradition, the Hebrew people are setting up an altar and are going to worship this idol, this golden calf. They're making sacrifices and worshiping at this altar, even though it is not an altar to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, of which Moses is speaking about. On the next day after the idol has been made, Aaron is leading the people people in a celebration of eating and drinking, and having their own festival to worship the idol. At the same time, God is speaking with Moses at the top of Mount Sinai, and God sees what is happening and decides that he will destroy his people because of the way that they are acting. You know, our God of the Old Testament is sometimes an angry God. We don't think of God being angry today. When bad things happen to someone, we know that in our faith, it isn't God punishing that person. Some serious illness is not a diagnosis because of the sins of a certain person. As Christians, we think about and remember the loving God who sent Jesus to die for our sins and to teach us and to lead us. But we should also spend some time thinking about our Old Testament and how we got here. So as I was looking at the scripture this week and I came to this Exodus passage, I realized that this is one of those stories that we struggle with because we find an angry God. The people are not doing what they are supposed to. Even though we can believe that they have heard the rules from the Ten Commandments as God was speaking to Moses, these folks are purposefully disobeying God, getting angry with God. I preached a few weeks ago about the people who were thirsty and didn't get something to drink in their time. And they didn't want to wait for God to provide for them. But here we are again. Another example of the impatience of the people waiting for Moses. And then we come to God getting angry and wanting to destroy God's people. But Moses steps in. Moses knows that the people are frustrated. He knows that they are not being faithful. He knows that there is still more work to do with them, and here he is with these two tablets of rules to follow. One of those rules specifically going against what is happening with false idols, and yet, even though Moses is probably just as angry with the people, he still makes an argument to God for not destroying God's people. Moses is standing up for those who are making a mistake and are not following the rules that God has laid out. But Moses still believes that they are good people. He still believes that they should be taken care of. Moses still loves his people. And Moses knows that God loves God's people too. Now, I both love and hate the words that God uses to describe the Israelites here. He calls them those stiff-necked people. So one question for you this morning is, when are you stubborn in your life? Or when are you stubborn in your faith? When have you been waiting for God and just got tired of waiting? You know, a passage like this allows us to find ourselves in the story. Because we too are chosen people who love God and we're following God's plan for us with our own free will to make choices, of course. But we still come to God. The Israelites made these graven images. They made this golden calf. They are turning their jewelry into this idol to worship. They are looking at material things that are taking their attention away from God and from being faithful. You know, they don't want to wait for Moses to come down. More importantly, they don't want to wait for God to guide them on their next step. If we look at the past few chapters of Exodus and even look ahead from this point, we find that Moses is going up and down the mountain a number of times to speak with God. Later, we will find that God comes to Moses and meets with him in his tent that Moses sets up. But right now, Moses has to travel up the mountain to speak with God. Now, I grew up near the Appalachian Trail, not too far north of here. And I used to go up and over the mountain a number of times when I would travel from Tulago to Allentown. I enjoyed traveling out to the western part of the state when you get towards State College and there are these rolling hills. And I think about as we travel these hills and how sometimes those hills can turn into mountains very quickly. Now, I know that it would be difficult for me to be sitting at the base of one of these mountains and waiting for Moses to come and give us more direction. I think it would probably be pretty easy to lose our faith and lose our direction when our leader goes away for days at a time and just leaves us sitting waiting for food and shelter and a plan to move on. Well, today in our faith, we don't have someone go up a mountain to listen to God. The pastor of a church does not speak with God directly and find out what the next plan is going to be for moving the church forward or taking the next steps in formation. We may have moments of the Holy Spirit guiding us, but no one speaks to God directly today as what happened back in Moses' time. The Israelites were here in our story being impatient. They were getting distracted by shiny things that they could get their hands on. There are times that we are impatient and that we can get distracted too. Now, I'm glad that we don't come to church on a Sunday morning, at least in normal times, and decide to take off our jewelry and create something else that we worship. Because you see, we come as faithful people to sit in front of the cross, to sit in front of Christ, to worship God. But you know, we can get impatient as we wait for good news to happen instead of hearing another bad news report or a new illness or diagnosis. We can get impatient as we wait for the world to get back to normal. But if we start trying to be normal too soon, then we might go back even farther. As people of faith, we worship the God that we love and the God that we know loves us. We aren't living in fear today that if we struggle in our faith, that God will come down and destroy us. We don't follow Moses, who speaks with God directly, but we follow Jesus, who has taught us how to be faithful people. And we know that because of Jesus, we are safe and loved and protected people of God. If you heard or watched my sermon from last week, I was talking about inviting people to church because Jesus was telling that story about who should be invited to the party. We celebrated worldwide communion with people around the world, and we weren't just inviting people to church, but the idea was to invite people to the table of Christ and that memorial meal. In this story, we are all invited to worship God and not get distracted by shiny things. It isn't even that we should avoid getting lost in the things of possessions, although that is true. We just need to make sure that we don't get lost in the things, in any and all things that could take us away from worshiping God. Now on Sunday afternoon, We are inviting people to come for a time of fellowship. And if you're in our prop walk, you don't need to necessarily raise money or do anything, then come out to walk and show your support and raise awareness for those who are hungry. You know, we can get distracted by things like football games and other family activities, but we can also have a nice walk together as a family, as a church family, and as a family of faith as we come to a place where we can find God. God is present with us as we continue the work of the church. God is present with us as we sometimes struggle in our faith. God is present with us when we make a mistake. And we know that God is not here to punish or lash out. Even though it seemed to take some convincing, God's compassionate and forgiveness side, he's already started to show in the stories from Exodus. You see, Moses helps God's people to understand their own faith. And God helps God's people by loving them and by giving them a second chance. May we always find the God of love to be present with us. And may we always find ways to share the love of God and not get distracted by our own desires. Amen.
Thank you.
come before God in a spirit of prayer. O compassionate God, there is so much that is on our hearts and our minds this day. We ask that you will continue to watch over all of the people who are in the path of hurricanes and wildfires in various parts of our country. We lift up to you the people who are struggling this day with financial or emotional or physical challenges. We know that even though we may get tired of waiting and the message may not come down from the top of the mountain, that you will continue to bless us in our work. We ask that you continue to watch over the people who are in pain and hurt. There are so many things that people are dealing with today, and so we ask that you will hear us as we lift up to you now the name of those that we are especially concerned for, including Scott Wales and Joanne and Ted, Jake Weinfelder and Mary Ann Duchelle, Joanne McLean and Lewis and Luthandis, Megan Quick and Cheryl Hanahan, John Alderman and Kristen Cameron, Randy Straub and Kevin Hefty, Joe and Mary Ann, Sandra Gargantio, Misa Oakes and Linda Lesher, John Bachman and James O'Rourke, Linda Bachman and Scott Arndt, Mary Ann Blyer and Rory Howard, Brian Folk and Ryan Mechtel, Gwen Lukowski and Geraldine Folk, Deb Kirshner and Bob Krause, and Kevin Pottinger. We lift up to you first responders, doctors, and nurses, especially Paige and Danielle and Pete Lukowski. We continue to pray for the men and women serving in our armed forces. May they all be kept safe, whether they are serving here at home or on foreign soil. We ask that you will hear us now as we join our voices together, praying the prayer that your Son taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. May we, as people of faith, always find time for God and not get distracted by those shiny things in life. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you.